Hello guys, welcome to yet another session of WOTAD, one topic a day. And today again we are going to do retina, and in retina the topic is diabetic retinopathy. I've already given you questions on the various forum that I am on Facebook, Insta and Telegram, and also on my WhatsApp groups. So we will proceed right away to discussing the various questions. So question number one talks about the main therapeutic option for diabetic macular edema. Okay, so the main therapeutic option. So let's see what are the options that are given to us. Intravitreal triamcinolone. Yes, it is being used for diabetic macular edema. So should we just right away go with option A? No, it's always good to look at the other options as well. Intravitreal anti-VEGFs. Yes, now the treatment paradigm has changed to such an extent that the first option that we normally resort to nowadays is intravitreal anti-VEGF. So this sounds more good to me. Now looking at option C, which is pan-retinal photocoagulation, PRP, which many of you had selected. See, PRP is the treatment of choice for proliferative diabetic retinopathy, which is independent of diabetic macular edema. Patient may have diabetic macular edema, DME, in the presence or absence of PDR. Or similarly, patient can have a PDR along with DME or in the absence of DME. Okay. So, and PRP is not part of the treatment for diabetic macular edema. We have macular grid laser. Yes. Okay. Macular grid laser. Yes. That's different. It's done with a lower laser power settings, unlike PRP, where macula is spared. You remember PRP, the macula is spared. So it is a treatment of choice for PDR only. So this is straight away ruled out. Now what about vitrectomy? Yes, vitrectomy is an option, but it is an option only if you have a refractory diabetic or, you know, any cause of macular edema, which is not responding to any modality of treatment. Only then we resort to doing a pars plana vitrectomy, because it takes care of this vitromacular traction component. So sometimes you can have a vitromacular traction, or there can be an epiretinal membrane which is causing, you know, dysfunction of the macula, the physiology, and resulting in macular edema could be. So in those cases, yes, vitrectomy. But we're talking about main therapeutic option, which is definitely not vitrectomy. Although yes, vitrectomy is part of the treatment arsenal. Now, so coming to our answer. So we are left with A and B. So the main therapeutic option, as I told you, we mainly resort to intravitreal injections of anti-VEGF. Okay. So that is your answer in this scenario. So what are the anti-VEGFs that you know of? So we have bevacizumab, then we have ranibizumab, then we have aflibercept, then we have pegabtinib. Okay, so these are monoclonal antibodies to the VEGF receptor. Okay, so these are antibodies to the monoclonal antibodies against the VEGF receptor. So aflibercept is a fusion protein. Okay, it's a fusion protein which acts like a decoy molecule and traps the VEGF. Now pegabtinib is an aptamer. Okay, so these are essential things that you should know about anti-VEGFs. Now anti-VEGFs are always given as intravitreal injection through the pars plana. All right, so we'll move to the next question. The next question, CSME, clinically significant macular edema, is detected by. Okay, so let's move on to the options. Slit lamp biomicroscopy. Yes, I can look at the fundus, I can look at the macular edema. So when I say clinically significant macular edema, what exactly am I looking for? What findings? I'm looking for retinal thickening and also looking for a significant amount of hard exudates. Okay, significant amount of hard exudates. So slit lamp biomicroscopy, yes, but let me look at the other options as well. OCT. Yes, on OCT, I can find out retinal thickening and hard exudates will be evident. But my question, please go back and look at the question. It is detected by. Now, I would not order an OCT unless I find something or I detect something on a clinical examination, right? So OCT may not be the answer. That's my guess. So let's look at option C, FFA, fundus fluorescein angiography. I cannot find out retinal thickening nor hard exudates on FFA. FFA, I can find out dye leak. I can look for pooling of the blood. I can look for microaneurysm, subretinal fluid, but not retinal thickening or hard exudates. So straight away, it's ruled out. Now, what is autofluorescence? So autofluorescence is an imaging technique where there is no need for this fluorescein dye to be injected. See, in FFA, you remember that we inject dye in the arm, the fluorescein dye. Here, there is no need for fluorescein dye. Then how will it fluoresce? Because of the inherent fluorescence of this wear and tear pigment called as lipofuscin. Where is this lipofuscin present? It is present at the retinal pigment epithelium. So this gives rise to a background autofluorescence in all of us. So this is especially useful, this imaging technique, when we have any problem with the RPE. All right. So it is based on lipofuscin, and where is lipofuscin present? In the RPE. So we will talk about autofluorescence in some other condition. Okay. So right now we know for sure that autofluorescence has no role in finding out CSNA, in the sense we can't find out retinal thickening nor hard exudates, because hard exudates do not contain lipofuscin. What do they contain? They contain lipoproteinaceous proteins. So basically they are lipoproteinaceous deposits, right? Okay. So that is also an MCQ. So coming back to my question, it is detected. So it is detected on slit lamp biomicroscopy. So only if I find this on slit lamp biomicroscopy, I will want to quantify the retinal thickening. Then I would order OCT. Okay. So it's very, very, you know, it looks very easy, but still could turn out to be a little tricky, this question. Okay. Now, what do you do on slit lamp biomicroscopy to find out this macular edema, or how do you visualize the fundus? So along with the slit lamp, we are going to use certain lenses. So it could be either a 90 diopter lens or a 78 diopter lens, which do not touch the eye, or another lens which is called as a Goldman 3 mirror lens. Okay, the Goldman 3 mirror gonioscope has a central lens of power plus 60D. So using any of these techniques, you can do the slit lamp biomicroscopy to visualize the fundus. Okay. So we move to question number 3. Now, ischemic maculopathy is evident on FFA as. Okay. Now, what is ischemic maculopathy? Now, first of all, when I say this ischemic maculopathy, it's basically macular edema with an ischemic component to it. Okay, with an ischemic component to it. Now, how will I know that there is an ischemic component to it? Only when I do a fundus fluorescein angiography. So to diagnose ischemic maculopathy, which investigation is mandatory? FFA is mandatory. So how will I know? So let's see what is there on a routine FFA. Now, we are injecting the fluorescein dye in the arm, and it reaches the eye, the retinal vasculature. So what happens is you will be able to see the dye in the vessels. And as you keep tracing the vessels, you will see that all the capillaries stop at one point in the macula. So there's a certain area here. Okay, it does not have a circular boundary like this. I'm just showing it to you. So this certain area where there's no capillary at all, which is normal. Okay, this is normal anatomy in you and me. So this is called FAZ. What is FAZ? Foveal avascular zone. Now, foveal avascular zone normally measures, the diameter measures around 500 microns. Now, when I have an ischemic maculopathy, what happens? The size of the FAZ increases. So, when I see an increased FAZ zone, then I call it ischemic maculopathy. Now, why is it important for me? Now, if I plan to do a macular grid laser, okay, if I plan to do a macular grid laser in this case, okay, where I have an ischemic maculopathy, I should not do it because it is contraindicated. So if I find out there is an ischemic component to this macular edema, I should not be doing a macular grid laser. I always have other modalities to treat it. Okay, so let's look at the options now. Option A, pinpoint hyperfluorescent dots on macula. So pinpoint means, so when you insert the when you inject the dye, you will see nice white spots. Okay, now I am marking it as red. So these microaneurysms will light up. So pinpoint hyperfluorescent dots at the macula describes the microaneurysm. Now I'm not talking about microaneurysm in my question, so this is definitely not the answer. Now diffuse leakage of dye. Now diffuse leakage of dye can happen when there is neovascularization. The new vessels will leak, which again is not the case. I'm just asking about ischemic maculopathy. Shrinkage of FAZ area. Now that we know the concept, we know for sure this is not the answer. So what is the answer? Option D, which is increase in the FAZ diameter. So when it is more than 500 microns, then we entertain this diagnosis of ischemic maculopathy. All right, have you understood this? Okay, so we'll move to the next question. So the next question, fundus examination of a 46-year-old female with type 2 diabetes for 6 months duration reveals tiny red dots at the posterior pole. So probably we are talking about, they're describing microaneurysms. Okay, the tiny red dots. Okay, so the tiny red dots in the posterior pole. She's also known to have high triglyceride levels. So that means we know that she is having another risk factor for diabetic retinopathy. Okay, see, type 2 diabetes, you might say, ma'am, she's only having for 6 months. How will she have diabetic retinopathy? See, 5% of type 2 diabetic patients are known to have DR at the time of diagnosis of diabetes mellitus. Okay, so we always assume that any patient with diabetes, especially type 2 diabetes, when we diagnose them based on their blood sugar levels itself, they have diabetic retinopathy. Now this lady does have some finding on fundus examination. Okay, so is it PDR or NPDR? So microaneurysm comes under non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So this is her diagnosis. Now what stage? We have only microaneurysm. So when you have only microaneurysm, it is a very mild stage of NPDR. Now when you have early stages of NPDR, okay, like very mild, mild and moderate, you only ask the patient to come for periodic follow-ups, okay, which is an annual follow-up every 12 months. And they have to have strict control of their sugar levels, okay, and the risk factors like hypertension, renal parameters, lipid levels. So all these have to be controlled, okay. So and as I told you, repeated fundus examination. So my question here is, management includes all except. So let's look at the options. Option A, pan-retinal photocoagulation. No, we know this is done only for PDR. So our patient is only a case of very mild NPDR. Good glycemic control, of course, yes. So what do you mean by good glycemic control? HbA1c level between 6 to 7%. Okay, so that is described as good glycemic control in a patient, especially when you are wanting to control the progression of diabetic retinopathy, or you want to delay the appearance of diabetic retinopathy. Lowering triglyceride levels, because yes, high lipid levels are considered as a risk factor. So yes, she has to control her triglyceride levels pharmacologically and through diet. Review fundus examination, yes, of course, after a year. So all these have to be done. But what is my question? Management includes all except. So the answer for this question is option A. Do you understand? Okay, so let's move on to the next question. Name the procedure that has been performed. Okay, so that gives us an image. So this is an image of the left fundus. Now, why left fundus? As always, your optic disc is located nasally. And you see a lot of spots. So you see spots where all around the retina, all over on the retina, except the macula. So there is a macular sparing, and these are freshly lasered spots. Okay, freshly lasered spots. So all over, pan retinal photocoagulation. So this is pan retinal photocoagulation with macular sparing. Okay, so let's look at the other options. Cryotherapy. Cryotherapy is applying ice balls, okay, ice crystals. So this can be done only at the anterior retina, or what we call as peripheral retina, close to the pars plana area. That is where you will be able to apply the cryoprobe. You can't apply the cryoprobe beyond the equator. Okay, we have a physical limitation to doing the procedure. So this is definitely not cryotherapy. Barrage laser. What is barrage laser? Barrage laser is a procedure that is done to treat retinal holes or retinal tears, or you know, some of the lattice degeneration. So let's say there is a retinal tear here. Do you see the tear? So around this, we're going to apply three rows of laser spots, thereby barraging the retinal break, preventing a retinal detachment from happening. So that's called barrage laser. Does it look like barrage laser, our picture? No. We know it's pan-retinal photocoagulation. And D, LASIK is a corneal procedure. We are looking at the fundus, the retina. So again, no. So this is a pan-retinal photocoagulation. So we are back with one pick a day keeps fear of ophthal away. I'm sure you really enjoyed this picture, looking at this picture. You know, so beautifully the laser has been performed. So we are done with our OTAT session today and our one pick a day session today. So I have a little question for you. You will go and read up how to diagnose CSME. What is the criteria? Okay, I told you about retinal thickening and hard exudates, but there's just a little more to it. So that's a homework that you will do, because again, the next OTAT session is going to be on diabetic retinopathy only, because there's so much to ask in diabetic retinopathy, so much to discuss. So we will continue with diabetic retinopathy in the next session. So until then, guys, have a good time learning ophthal, and I hope that I'm spreading ophthal love, that I love so much ophthal, and I hope that you also have started developing at least a tiny bit of love. So this is Dr. Rajaratna signing off. You can always DM me on my Insta or my FB page. All right, thank you guys. Study well, go back and read diabetic retinopathy now. All the best. God bless you.